Welcome to Sun City News. I'm your host, Norma Taylor. Now, renovations at Pinckney Hall have suspended SCTV operating on cable systems till October 2022. However, you can still catch some of our SCTV programs on our SCTV YouTube channel. So, let's start our October news show with some of the following stories. Georgia Lash has an interview with the United Way of the Lowcountry Volunteer Coordinator. Our news team attended the 9/11 memorial service here in Sun City. And later in the program, we have coverage of the first collaboration between the All About Art Club and the Avant Gardeners Club. Those stories and so much more coming up. Sun City News starts now.
From our studios in Pinckney Hall, this is Sun City News with Norma Taylor. Entertainment news with Randy Selman. Sports with Doug Wright. And the entire Sun City News team covering your community and the South Carolina Lowcountry.
Reporter Georgia Lash caught up with the volunteer coordinator of the Lowcountry of the United Way. Let's listen.
Sherry, we come from all parts of the world here in Sun City, and we're aware of United Way, but please tell us about our local United Way of the Lowcountry.
Yes, the United Way of the Lowcountry, we offer the we help with the immediate needs of the community, serving our neighbors. But we also have a focus on long-lasting ways of helping our community by focusing on education, basic needs, economic mobility, and health.
Now, I'm sure that in that mission, you have some volunteer opportunities, and Sun City is full of eager helpers. So what would be those opportunities?
So for me, again, like you stated, with people being from everywhere, all over Sun City, we need your help. We need volunteers. We know that people may have volunteered at the United Way where they're from, maybe even donated money in a workplace campaign, but we need people to help us in those areas. So for us, I am the volunteer coordinator at United Way, and one of the main focuses is for volunteers in our Read and Deed program. We have tutors that help in the school system. They tutor first through third graders in Jasper and Beaufort County. We currently have availability for volunteers only for one day a week, up to 1 to 2 hours at the school. We're going to do in person. We know that this year is going to be a greater need than any year before, prior to COVID. The kids are definitely going to need our help to help them get up to the grade level, reading grade level. The students are evaluated by the teachers, and the ones that are behind are the ones that we're going to be helping. We also have community impact. These are volunteers that donate their money, but also are able to tell us where that money goes to the different local agencies. All of our funds that are raised do stay here locally in the United Way, in the community of the Lowcountry, which is really nice. And Danita's here today, and she's going to talk about VITA.
Okay, Danita, another Sun City resident, one of those eager volunteers. Tell us, what is VITA?
VITA stands for Volunteer Income Tax Assistance, and it's an IRS-sponsored program administered by the United Way that helps tax clients prepare their taxes who are unable to do it on their own. We have four sites that are near Sun City, and we need volunteers to be tax preparers. We also need greeters, especially, who organize the incoming clients. We do not take appointments. We have a walk-in basis, and it's very important for the greeter to screen people. You get to meet the people, interview them, and find out if we can do their tax return. Do they have the right documents with them? So we really need people to do this, and we need substitutes for both jobs as well, because we understand tax season happens to overlap with cruise season, and we know that people need to be absent now and then, and we fully understand. We ask for a commitment of once a week, 4 or 5 hours at one site, one day.
Okay. But let me just quickly ask, is there training?
Yes, there is training. We have online training in December and January, and You can also be sort of an apprentice with a senior preparer or a greeter. We take you under our wing. We will not abandon you. We're very grateful for your help.
Ah, great. Now, Sherry, finish us up with how do we eager residents that want to help contact you?
Yes, so I want you to go ahead and call me, or you can email me. But if you want to just check us out, you can go to uwlowcountry.org. That's our website.
Let's be on the lookout for those opportunities. Thank you, ladies, for what you do.
Our news crew was at the Sun City Veterans Association and Shalom Club's September 11th Memorial Event. Let's watch the video.
I'm here with Phil Weisware. Okay, sorry, Phil. And you're president of the Shalom Club.
President of the Shalom Club.
So tell us, what's the importance for this Shalom Club to be sponsoring this 9/11 ceremony?
Well, as you know, it was 21 years ago, we had this horrific event that took thousands of lives, and the Shalom Club felt very honored that they would be allowed to put a monument up here in honor, and every year have a ceremony to recognize all those that died.
I'm here with Dave Davis, who's the commander of the Sun City Veterans Association. And Dave, what's the importance of today?
Today, it's we need to recognize the fact that our country was viciously attacked 21 years ago and stole the lives of over 3,000 citizens of our country. And it is important for us to remember those victims of the of that attack, and to tell their story, because as long as we continue to tell their story, then they stay in our minds, in our memories.
So what kind of ceremony are you planning today?
We're going to have an introduction, of course. We have to present the colors, have an invocation. We're going to have a guest speaker who's going to talk about the significance of today. And then we also have what they call the four fives. This is the bell ringing for the firefighters that were lost, and over 300 New York City firefighters that were lost during the attempt to save the citizens. And then we'll have a playing of taps.
I'm here with Dennis Banage. And Dennis, you were a firefighter at 9/11. Tell us about it.
Well, I was a firefighter in New York City for 25 years. On 9/11, I was working at that time in the borough of Queens. And that afternoon, we headed over into Manhattan. Got there after the South Tower had already fallen and proceeded to actually run for our lives after the North Tower started to come down. And then we spent months, weeks, days there digging, looking, hoping to find some survivors, which obviously everybody knows there wasn't any really. And got sick after it for a couple of months with breathing problems, but it's not as half as bad as a lot of people that are not with us. We've already lost probably over close to 200 people since 9/11 to different cancers and diseases they picked up from working on the pile, which we called it. And now it's 21 years later. I'm living here in Sun City for 16 years, and I love it. And just happy, every day's a gift, and happy to be here and know people like you.
Well, thank you. Thank you for your service and for coming to this celebration. Well, obviously, it means an awful lot to you.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Coming up next, Chris Chase checked out the Memory Matters 5K run. And Georgia Lash attended the recent Buckeye Group's Pancake Breakfast. So don't go away. We'll return after a brief break.
With the new studio and lots of new residents, Sun City TV invites you to join our crew. Our growing technology presence requires enthusiastic, creative volunteers as camera persons, editors, script coordinators, reporters, audio and visual support staff. No previous TV experience needed. Many of the volunteer positions require about 1 hour a week. Email us at suncitytvhh@gmail.com to learn more.
Fun was had by all at the Memory Matters Move Your Mind race at May River High School. Reporter Chris Chase spoke with Joy Nelson, Director of Marketing and Communications.
Now, Joy, you are responsible for this whole wonderful event. It must have taken quite a bit to coordinate this.
Well, yes. First of all, it was a team effort. I always say we have a small staff with big hearts, and this was truly a team effort amongst everybody. But yes, we started publicizing this in June and started working on it in June. And I'm so excited that the day's here and so excited that we had so many people come out. I was afraid the weather was gonna hold people back, but we've had a great crowd out here this morning.
Now, this is your second annual. I'm assuming there's going to be a third.
Absolutely. This is going to be an annual event that we hold here at May River. So the larger this event grows, we've got the room to accommodate that. So we're really excited that May River allows us to come out here. But yes, we will definitely be back. So if you didn't make it this year, plan on September next year coming out and supporting Memory Matters.
Now, if they want to do that, how would they find out the dates, times, and that information?
So I haven't picked the date yet because I've got to work with Rob for Palmetto Running Company, who they do a lot of the hard work behind this too. They do all the bibs, the t-shirts, everything. So it'll probably be mid-September, but just keep an eye on mymemorymatters.org and any information, or you can sign up for our bi-monthly newsletter. The same way, going to mymemorymatters.org, and in that newsletter, not only will it give you information about the next year's race, but it will also give you the latest event information or our programs and services announcements. So the newsletter is a great way to keep in touch with all of our announcements.
So Joy, how did you get involved with this?
Yeah, so I have spent a majority of my career working in communications and marketing and newsrooms. But my father-in-law suffered from Alzheimer's disease for 10 years before his passing. And my mother-in-law was the sole caregiver. So Memory Matters just reached my heart. You know, you don't start working for nonprofits for the money, but you do it because you care for the mission, you care for the message, and the fact that I can get our message out to more people because of my experience allows more local families to be helped by our programs and services. And that is so important. The key, COVID really hurt us in the fact of, you know, we lost some participants and not everybody's back up. So, and there's been a lot of people that have moved to the area in the last 2 or 3 years. So really getting that message out there that we can help the caregiver, we can help the individual in so many ways.
So Tom, what brings you out here today?
I'm out here to volunteer to help with the runners, to give them some water and some food.
It's a lot of fun out here today, isn't it? So Susan, what are you doing out here today?
The same thing, I volunteer. I have family members that passed away, but they had Alzheimer's before people knew how to help. And I have a brother-in-law who's going through the process now. So having spent time with him and my family, I know it's invaluable, really, it's invaluable to have groups like this that can help out. They help the caregivers, they help the extended family, and they help the person who needs assistance also. So I'm happy to be here.
One of September's Sun City traditions is the Buckeye Group's pancake breakfast. Our SCTV crew stopped in to see what's cooking.
What is going on here? We've got a lot of cars. Looks like a beautiful mini car show. And that's about a month early from your annual car show. So please explain.
We're here to help the Buckeye Group support staying connected. That's the same group that we for our car show, our profits go to them too. And it's neighbors helping neighbors, just like clubs helping clubs.
That's great. Now, remind everybody, when do we get to come and see probably 100 more cars than this?
There will be about 100 more than 100 more. It'll take up this entire parking lot on October 22nd. That's a Saturday. And this is our 22nd annual car show. So we've been around a while.
Well, we will be there.
Okay.
Ron, the Buckeye Group has a reputation for being a fun group, but you're also probably one of the most charitable organizations in Sun City. So tell us what's going on today with the pancake breakfast and who's going to benefit.
Okay, today is our pancake annual pancake breakfast, and it's going to benefit Staying Connected. All proceeds will go for the Staying Connected.
Now, you make this sound like, oh, we're just doing our pancake breakfast. This is an effort. How many volunteer hours, how many volunteers put this thing together?
Today we have 20 volunteers here in the morning, and then we have another shift coming in at 10 o'clock from 10 to 12, which is another 20. So we're looking at about 40 volunteers, plus two or three of us that went and did all the shopping and got this place ready to go for today.
What else is on the agenda for the Buckeye Group this year?
October 13th, we're having our Oktoberfest over at Lake Somerset. It'll be outside. We got a cornhole tournament. We're going to have a food truck. And then December 18th, we are having our annual Christmas party. So there's a lot of dates. There's a lot of good information on the website.
And join hundreds of members that come to you, whether they're from OHIO or not.
Right. Our deal is if you can spell Ohio or ever drove through it, you can be a member.
Thank you. Hey, we are watching the action taking place here. It is Pancake City. They are flipping. They are grilling. What is the secret here, guys?
Well, you have to have a good pourer.
Who's the pourer?
Me.
Oh, okay. Then we got a good one.
Yeah, I figure we're going to do about 2,000 pancakes today.
Okay, that's more than I make in a lifetime. Lori, besides a delicious breakfast we're going to get today, what else is going on here for the Pancake Breakfast Staying Connected fundraiser?
Well, yes, we have a silent auction going on. This year we did a little different. We had it online for the last week, and so far online we've already sold a majority of the items, over $4,000. Yes, woo! yes. So we were really excited. Yeah, but we still have some items, and so hopefully everything will be gone today. And people were just so great donating items to the silent auction, and of course, purchasing the items from our silent auction.
I'll tell you, you are the silent auction queen, and thank you, and good luck, and thank you for donating to Staying Connected.
Wreaths Across America is a national project to purchase wreaths for veterans' graves each December. The mission statement is remember, honor, and teach. Wreaths are $15. The fresh wreaths are made in Maine and shipped by volunteers all over the country. Now, last year, 52 Sun City neighborhoods raised $81,392. That's $24,000 more than in 2020. Enabling us to place wreaths on every grave. This year, we'll start out at the club fair on October 1st, just outside of Pinckney Hall. Please stop by and donate. Collections will be from October 1st to November 15th. The ceremony will be December 17th at the Buford National Cemetery. Now, for more information, contact Andy Horner on the south side or Chris Chase on the north side. Still more to come on Sun City News. Randy Selman checks out some great fall productions, including Little Shop of Horrors at the Art Center on Hilton Head, in her entertainment report. We have coverage of the first Art and Bloom show. And Georgia Lash sits in for Doug Wright with a sports report. We'll be right back.
Let's fall into our October show. I kill myself. A pool party at the Riverbend Lodge. At the Lodge? A trivia night at the Pavilion.
Round one.
A happy hour in a neighborhood, within a neighborhood. And a neighborhood barbecue, also at the Pavilion. You will have to tune into In Our Neighborhood to find out the answers. Hope you'll be watching.
Now let's head over to Randy Selman for some entertainment news.
The fall season is once again bringing bright, cool mornings and evening breezes. Along with this time of the year is a new offering of theater productions in both Sun City and beyond their gates. The Art Center of Coastal Carolina is opening their new season with the iconic sci-fi rock musical, Little Shop of Horrors. I had the opportunity to catch up with director Whitaker Gannon before the opening curtain. Let's take a look.
So Whitaker, the last time I saw you was at the opening of The Curious Incident of the Dog in the Nighttime, and it was great, I have to tell
you.
But I think that this show, Little Shop of Horrors, and that show are probably two of the most theater experiences that would be opposite. It's like on different planets.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about Little Shop.
Oh yeah, absolutely. They are completely different. I mean, they're both about underdogs who are trying to navigate a strange world, but One has a big old musical with a giant man-eating plant, so it's a little bit different. For anyone who's not familiar with the movie that was made in the 1980s that really made this musical a fan favorite, Little Shop of Horrors is about a meek florist assistant who out of nowhere discovers this strange and interesting new breed of plant that seems like it's from out of this world. And he takes it under his care, but little does he know at the time that this seemingly innocent and inanimate plant isn't quite as inanimate as he once thought. All of a sudden, the plant starts talking and singing too. Wait for the musical numbers with that guy. It starts singing and talking and promising Seymour fame and fortune if, as long as he keeps feeding it. So it sounds crazy, and it is a little crazy just to describe it, but it's so fun. It's absurd in all the right ways. It's definitely got a little bit of sci-fi in there. It's got a little bit of horror and a ton of comedy, big song and dance number. So it's really got a little something for everybody. It's a blast. You should definitely come and see it.
It's great music. One of my favorite scores of all the musicals. It's just so much fun to listen to. This show is so iconic. Did you use any of your directing skills to change it up a little bit to make it your own?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, we definitely wanted to pay tribute to the original because it's so beloved by so many people worldwide. But it was important for us to, you know, bring some freshness to it and to kind of put our own spin on it as well.
The show runs until October 30th. For more information or to order tickets, go to artshai.com or call 842-2787. The Sun City Theater Club will be presenting 12 Angry Men. More about this show and other happenings in Sun City on our next show. I'm Randy Selman, and that's your entertainment report. Remember, life is entertaining, so don't miss the show.
Combine flowers and fine art, and the result is a unique art show called Art in Bloom. Let's take a look.
Our All About Art Club is at it once again. They are collaborating, and this time with a different group, the Sun City Avant-Gardeners. Let's see what's growing on with the show, Art in Bloom. Pauline, tell us about this collaboration.
Well, when I moved here, I was a docent at a museum in Connecticut, and I went to the art club, and I said, why don't we do this program called Matching Flowers with Our Artist, because it's really big up north, and they've never done it before. So I thought it would be a great idea to collaborate some of the Sun City talent that we have. So we met with the art group and the flower group, and they thought it was a great idea, and then it went from there.
How were the pairings created?
We submit the paintings were submitted to me by email, you know, and we had 33 entries, and then we met with the flower club, the garden club, and they picked the ones that would best be suited for their artist using the elements of art. And we narrowed it down to 13. And we could have gone more, but it was really hard. So we have 13 pairings in the show.
Awesome, awesome. What was the inspiration?
The inspiration was really Pauline, because she came to, I met her when I first moved here, and she says, oh, I have a lot of ideas for the art club, but I'm not an artist. I said, you can bring them to the art club, and we can share and see what works. So that's when she talked about Art in Bloom, that's how it started.
How eager were your artists to jump in on this sort of new twist?
What the heck was going on? They says, what exactly are we doing? So they were a little timid. But now I think they're all excited. The girls that are coming in now couldn't believe what was going on in there, so they love it.
Dorothy, I just spoke with the All About Art representatives about their artists, you know, wondering what was going to happen with this collaboration. They were going to have you interpret these things. And tell us about, from the Avant-Gardener's perspective, the design involved.
Well, I am the coordinator of the Designing with Flowers group, and I have many talented women in my group. And I presented this challenge to them. And of course, they were all a little apprehensive because many of the girls have never even done a flower show before. But with encouragement and a couple workshops, we were able to interpret the art from the perspective of a designer. I look at it as the artist goes out in nature and or in their studio and paints something, and then the painting is on the wall, and then my designer looked at it and recreated it in a floral arrangement.
I have a feeling there's going to be a beautiful variety, just like in a garden, of the interpretations.
You're going to see a spectacular array of talent.
Now here's Georgia Lash sitting in for Doug Wright with some sports news.
The monsoons of early September delayed the traditional dates for opening the fall softball season by almost 3 weeks, but the intrepid women athletes of the Peg Welch Ladies League managed to squeeze in their scheduled opening day, and our news crew was at the sports park to cover it.
Tell us about what's going to go on today and how many teams you got, etc.
Okay, well, thank you, Mother Nature. Please, you know, keep the tears. Today we're going to have, we have four teams in the Peg Welch Ladies League. We have 48 women who signed up. We have about 60 altogether, a number of subs. But we're going to have just a small opening ceremony with someone, actually Ruben Ariel Ola is going to play the trumpet. And there's going to be a guest pitcher who is a surprise. It's always a surprise. So we'll have a surprise pitcher, and then we'll just get started. So we want to keep Mother Nature at bay.
And did you garner any players from your triad day?
As a matter of fact, we did. We garnered quite a few. I believe we have at least 8 or 9 from our triad day, and a lot of ladies from the previous seasons. And there's some ladies who are playing a lot of softball who opted not to play this season. So we have four teams of 12. And something interesting about this season is we have a guest pitcher. We were short on pitchers, so we will have men pitching. And they'll have to stay within their circle.
Well, you know, keep them out of your realm.
That's right.
That works at my house. All right. Well, how many games will be played, and how long is the season?
Okay. Well, the games we're playing 10 games. We have a season that lasts from today, which is September 4th, until November the 12th, which is the championship day, and we'll have a round robin tournament at the end of the season. So we'll play a number of games, like about 4 games for that too.
All right. That's terrific.
Reporter Doug Wright also tracked down Roy Powers to get the lowdown on another postponed event, which has been rescheduled for November.
Roy, tell us about why we're here and how you got involved.
Well, I'm filling in for Mike Barato, who started this neighborhood golf challenge 9 years ago. This is the 9th year it's being held. We missed 1 year because of COVID. And it's going to be held November 12th. And it's really a neighborhood challenge for all of Sun City. You get 5 date guys, women from your neighborhood, all right? Sign them up with a neighborhood rep or a captain of your league, and you'll be ready to go. You'll be paired up. If you don't have a captain in your league, get a hold of Mike or I, and we'll put you on a team.
Okay, and it'll be played where and when again?
It is played November 12th. There are a shotgun start in the morning and afternoon, 8:30 and 1:30, I believe.
Well, Roy, we're here at the end of September. Tell us when registration information will be available.
Okay, official registration will not start till the middle of October. But what we want you to do is get a hold of your neighborhood rep right now. Get a hold of your captain right now. Sign up so your neighborhood is well represented when registration starts. And come that time, we'll have 8 people in each neighborhood, and off we go.
Speaking of golf, the PGA Tour is back in Ridgeland at Congaree Golf Club from October 20th through the 23rd. Hundreds of volunteers from Sun City are expected, and you can be one of them, so act now. Finally, our pickleball club hosts teams from Margaritaville on October 7th and 8th in the second annual Humana Cup, and we'll have the results of this matchup in our next report. Now, as Doug always says, put those electronics down and get that body in motion. This is Georgia Lash for Sun City Sports.
Well, that's your news update. Thank you for watching. A final note before we end our show. Due to the extensive renovations in Pinckney Hall, SCTV will not be on cable until early October. However, you can continue to view us on our YouTube channel. And we encourage you to subscribe to our YouTube channel, please visit us at www.youtube.com/SCTV station. Check highlights and alerts on Twitter at SunCityTVHHI. Also, email us at suncitytvhh@gmail.com. Now make sure you tune in to our news show to find out all the news that's happening in our community. For Sun City News, I'm Norma Taylor.